So this week on CyberSchool, we're going over video intercoms. We've been getting a lot of requests for our video intercoms about over the last year or so with the current pandemic and everything going on. And people are a little bit more cautious about letting people into their business. So we've seen a fairly dramatic uptick in requests and inquiries and even sales about our video intercoms. And I figured this was a good chance and a good occasion for us to go over the entire product line of video intercoms that we have and talk a little bit about them, what they do, what, you know, what the heck H.264 video means, and just kind of get a little bit more information about these products out. So, of course, what are video intercoms? So basically the easiest way to think about it and the way that I explain it to customers is it's our standard regular intercom with a video slapped onto it. So that, you know, a video camera slapped onto it. So it gives you that same kind of capability that you would expect out of one of our intercoms with two-way communication, you know, an onboard relay to trigger a door strike with the capability to actually view who's standing there at the intercom. And that can be really useful for businesses, for, you know, big parking lots for trucking companies, and basically any place that you would want to be able to monitor who's going through this particular entranceway. It can be really useful, of course, you know, in our current times to be able to see, you know, who's at the front door, to be able to just kind of, you know, you hear their voice, they say their name, but you'll actually be able to put a face to it if you can see them. So they're really, really useful with everything that's going on, and it's a great addition to the already awesome capability that you get of our standard audio-only intercoms. You're basically just getting all that same functionality and that usability that you get with the audio-only version, but you get video to pair with it. So it's really useful and very powerful. And the nice thing with the lens that we use on the camera itself is it gives a nice kind of fisheye spread, and you'll see that a little bit later as we talk about the different viewing angles with the video camera, but it gives you a capability to be able to see not only who's directly in front of the intercom, but people that might be off to the side or might be kind of standing right behind them, you know, if they're trying to gain access to the facility and they're in the, and, you know, they're going to pull ski masks over their face and kind of storm in and loot the place. So it gives you that kind of warm, comfy feeling because you're not only able to hear and talk to whoever you're speaking with, but you can see them as well. So you get all that kind of niceness paired with the intercom, of course, without losing anything like you would get from our standard intercoms. So the options that we have for our video intercom products are, of course, going to be kind of our standalone flagship, just the standard SIP H.264 video outdoor intercom, part number 011410. And that's basically just your basic intercom with video. You want to press a button and talk to somebody and let them in, but you also get to see who's there. So it gives you just that little bit of extra functionality out of the existing standard intercom. And then we go towards the two more access control centric devices, the SIP H.264 video outdoor intercom with keypad, part number 011414, and the SIP H.264 video outdoor intercom with RFID, part number 011478. And the nice thing with these two units is they're a little bit more access control centric, so they're great for entranceways or doorways where you might be dealing with not only patrons or clients to a particular business, but as well as, you know, regular employees. And it can be kind of cumbersome for people, you know, especially, you know, a secretary that's trying to handle, you know, sales and marketing and all that kind of stuff at the same time while also manning the front door. It can really create a hassle for that particular person if they have to go through and every single time that, you know, employees are coming into work or, you know, they go out for their lunch break and they're coming back to have to answer the phone, talk to whoever they are, and then buzz them in. You know, if you're doing that for 50, 60 employees, that's like an hour, hour and a half of somebody's time just going through and authenticating all those people and letting them through. So if you go for one of our keypad or our RFID intercom units, it gives the employees the capability to be able to essentially authenticate themselves to gain access to the facility by use of either using a key code or a key card with the RFID unit. And the nice thing with these units is they've got support for up to 500 different unique either key codes or key cards that are all time sensitive and unique to a particular user. So I, for example, could only have a key card or a key code that would be valid from Monday through Friday from 8 to 5. You know, regular business hours where, you know, John or my boss or, you know, whoever might have a card that's available all the time or might be available on the weekends if they need to come into the office and do a little bit of work when it's a little bit more quiet. So it gives them that capability and that leverage to be able to just get in through the door without having to interrupt that particular person who's has more tasks than simply just, you know, essentially being a door person, to be able to just, oh, you're allowed to come in. Go ahead, come through the door. So it really can kind of streamline work for and the process flow for a lot of people, not only the people that will be using that to be able to get in through that particular entranceway, but the people that would also be normally dealing with the people that might use these intercoms, because they won't have to for regular employees. But the nice thing with the keypad unit or the RFID unit is those patrons, the clients, your UPS guy, you know, whoever's kind of a non-standard person that's going to be coming up to the door, you know, somebody that isn't going through there every day, that doesn't have their own key card, can just simply press that call button and you get that same style of intercom functionality that you would expect out of a single button, where you can talk to the person and you can see them thanks to the camera and be able to grant them access if you want to allow them to come through the doorway. So it gives a lot of capability and really supplements the existing functionality of our analog only units, again, by just leveraging the video capability that we get with these units. So now that we know a little bit more about, you know, what is video access control, it's basically just access control with video, why would you want to use something like this? And the same process kind of applies when you're thinking about it as compared to a standard access control system, non-video, audio only, because mainly you're just trying to, you know, ensure the safety and security of everyone that is either entering through that doorway or might be on the other side of that doorway. So that way you can go and only allow authorized people through, or people that really need to be in the business. You know, if you're having somebody that's coming out to, say, do a job interview, you might not want to potentially contaminate everybody that's on the interior side of that building. And if you're having an in-person meeting, maybe you meet it, you know, at a picnic bench outside of the business, you know, and maybe an outdoors lunch area or something like that, just to be able to really kind of restrict and control the access to a particular building, which is just another great feature that you get from any kind of access control system. And it really allows you to kind of streamline and simplify access to, you know, through a particular door or multiple doorways with a system like this. So it really gives you a lot of capability and flexibility to be able to manage and view who's able to go through that unit because of the detailed logging and listing that you get on all of our endpoints. All of our endpoints support onboard local logging. So it's really easy to go and say, if you're only managing one or two doors, it makes it really easy, you know, on kind of say a monthly basis or what have you, to log into the unit and just download the logs. So that way you've got a consistent usage pattern of that particular doorway. Know exactly, you know, okay, John seems to like to come through this door more than the other. You know, maybe we should move his office around and make his, you know, walk across the building a little bit shorter. Or, hey, this guy's always going through this particular door and, you know, he's hiding and disappearing for 20 minutes after he's had, you know, his third smoke break of the day. What the heck is going on with that guy? And you can monitor that stuff. Just for kind of general purposes, but also, you know, if for some reason you have an unauthorized access to the facility and there's no, say, breaking and entering, you know, things that you see there, you know, they didn't take a pry bar and pry the door open or drill out the lock, you know, there's no marks like that. You think maybe they used the access control system. That detailed log of exactly when a card was when a card or a code was used can be really helpful for those types of situations. And you get all of that kind of functionality with just the standard audio one, with the standard audio access control. But by adding video in there, you get to see everybody that interacts with that intercom and goes through and actually makes a call with the unit. You get to be able to see whoever goes through that particular unit as long as they, you know, made a call with it. Of course, it's not active when the unit's not in a call, so it's not particularly useful for the people that are scanning their key cards or punching in their key codes, but it gives you a lot of capability for the non-standard users, those people that are kind of, say, like, you know, your patrons, your clients, or people that could be coming to the facility. You can see everybody as they come through. So that really kind of supplements what you would already get from an existing audio access control system with video. You get the video aspect of it, so you get to see who's there. So now that we know a little bit about that, let's just kind of run through all the different specific features that you get with this intercom as well as any intercoms. So of course, you know, these are video intercoms and they support H.264 video, which is just a particular type of video encoding. It's at 320 by 240 resolution. So, you know, unfortunately it's not, you know, your 4K, you know, super fancy resolution, but this is kind of a standard resolution and it's good enough for what you're dealing with. We really recommend this as kind of a supplemental product to your existing video camera system, just because you can get so much more capability out of an existing video surveillance system as you could from, say, an intercom. We're more of a supplemental video option as compared to a full-fledged. You don't need a proper video camera at your front door. You can use the intercom. No, you should probably have both if you could, because you just get that extra little bit of capability to it. But with this intercom and all of our other intercoms, you get an onboard relay that's a normally open, temporarily closed style relay to be able to interface with different door strikes or gate controllers that you might encounter as you're setting up the unit. It's got a tamper sensor on the unit that actually deals with light and can tell when the front faceplate of the intercom has been removed from the back gang box. You can literally only move it about a quarter inch to a half an inch before the tamper sensor will trigger. And when the tamper sensor triggers, that can either make a call to a predetermined extension or phone number to say call security or call, you know, tech support, you know, what have you. You know, it can call just about anybody you want it to, but it can also just play a simple audio message locally, which can actually be a fairly good deterrent. You know, it might scare off, you know, that would-be aggressor that's trying to take the intercom off the wall if, for example, you load in an audio file of dogs barking, because, you know, they might just think, oh my gosh, there's dogs barking, they're sending the dogs after me, I gotta run away. You know, it's it you know, could potentially, you know, scare people away from potentially breaking into the unit. It's also got a wide support for a lot of different accessories that we offer that we'll cover a little bit more in depth, as well as remote switch support. So that way you can set up a push to exit button on the interior side of a door. And it provides a lot of cool flexibility with that. And then of course the keypad and the RFID units, since they've got those extra buttons or a slot to actually read key cards, can do even more. And you know, we really kind of hammered this in the last couple slides, but each of those units, the keypad or the RFID unit, support up to 500 unique time sensitive key codes or key cards, depending on the variant of product that you're using. So, you know, with any of our video line, you get, you know, a huge support of different features on there. But if you opt for the keypad or the key card units, you get so much more functionality out of it. Again, just due to all those extra buttons you get on the unit. So now that we've kind of talked about all the features, we kind of know what a video intercom is, but I keep throwing around this word H.264. What does that mean? H.264 is basically a name for this video, advanced video coding protocol that they'll use to actually go and take video and transmit it. It's really kind of a protocol that's designed to send good quality video at a low bit rate. So basically being able to send a high quality image, but not, you know, not sending and requiring a lot of bandwidth to be able to send that. It basically can package up that video stream in a really good way to be able to not take up a lot of network bandwidth and really slow your network down. It's really commonly used in telephony and kind of generic recording. It's really used all over the place. You'd be surprised, and I was really surprised at how prevalent H.264 video is in everything that we interact with. YouTube videos can use H.264 recording and transmission. You know, even Netflix can, you know, there's a lot of different providers out there that already leverage this kind of functionality. It's still kind of limited in telephony where it's really restricted based on the carriers that you're using, but we all kind of interact with H.264 video, especially today when we're doing all of our, you know, remote meetings, either through Teams, Zoom, you know, Cisco, WebEx, you know, what have you. They're all underneath the hood using some kind of H.264 video transmission. So it's really cool. It's really powerful. And, you know, it's still widely used today because it supports up to a maximum of 8K ultra high definition resolution, that ultra HD. So you can get some really, really crisp, awesome picture quality through H.264 video. It's really powerful. Of course, our stuff isn't, you know, 8K ultra high definition. It might be one day, but not currently. So now that we know a little bit about that, let's talk a little bit more about the fine details of setup. So when you're setting up the camera, it's got a mechanical range of motion of about 15 degrees on the top and bottom. So it gives you a pretty wide angle to be able to set up the intercom and be able to adjust the adjust the angle of the camera on the vertical axis. So if you've, say, got it mounted, you know, kind of middle length up the wall, you can adjust the camera up a little bit to be able to get a good face view of the particular users. Or if you've got the intercom mounted up a little high, say like on a gatepost or something, you might want to tilt the camera down a little bit lower, so that way you're not just, you know, picking up the sky or the roof or, you know, whatever's behind the people. You want to be able to see not only their face, but, you know, maybe what kind of clothes they're wearing to make sure, you know, they might be wearing the proper PPE for that particular location. And the nice thing is it's really easy to go and adjust these when you're actually setting up the intercom. It's got the tiny little screw that we have illustrated here that you just slightly loosen, and it gives you that full 15 degrees range of motion for that vertical axis. And when you find a nice spot that you like with it, you just simply tighten that screw back up and lock the camera in place. So it gives you a lot of capability to change the viewing angle of the camera, again, on that vertical axis. And how that works out is you get this nice little diagram that we created with all of our documentation to kind of give you ideas of how the system will look and the viewing angle that you'll get kind of based on the regular height of a person. So with this diagram that we have here, of course, just to kind of go over some basic information as we're talking about the diagram before we get into the different colors that illustrate the viewing angle, the intercom is mounted at what we recommend for a particular height, which is 52 inches from the ground. And the general interaction spacing that we have with people is usually around 2 feet. If you look from where would be the elbow of this particular silhouette of a man here, we've got that their elbow is measured at 20 inches away from the camera. We can see that as noted here. But generally, they're about 2 to 3 feet away from the unit itself. So depending on the angle of the camera and how it was actually mounted in there, if you see here with the blue angle, the blue lines here, that tells us that the camera is mounted in its utmost highest position, which would give us a great view of the head of the person as well as kind of their top torso to be able to see, you know, okay, if they're wearing any hats or dark glasses or anything like that, you'd be able to get a good view of them there. If you leave it in the standard position, which would be labeled as our black arrow, our black dash and our black line here, it gives you kind of, honestly, this would be a pretty bad viewing angle for this particular user. You know, if we're dealing with somebody that's about, what is that? Okay, I guess this guy's actually fairly short here. Look at this, 73 inches. How many feet is that? I'm not going to do math. But, you know, he's fairly tall here, but this black angle here really wouldn't give a good view of the person. You'd be able to kind of see their chest and their torso, but really wouldn't be able to see their face, you know, based on this line here. You're really kind of the top of the viewing angle is really kind of cutting out of this person's mouth. You might get a nice little, you know, up the nose shot there, but you get, you know, a decent viewing angle depending on where the unit's actually mounted. And then if we go for the lower viewing angle, as noted here by the red dashed lines and the red line here at the bottom, it gives you a really good view of basically their chest and their pants. So you can see, you know, exactly what outfit they're wearing, but you can't really see the person. So generally we recommend when you're dealing with a viewing angle that would be somewhere here in between the black and the blue line. So that way you can get a good view of not only, you know, their upper torso, but also their face. You know, it's really important to be able to see who you're actually talking to and not just, you know, the clothes they're wearing. You want to actually be able to see and confirm that the person you're talking to is actually the person that they claim to be. So it gives you a really nice viewing angle, which can range anywhere based on, you know, the illustration that we have here of upwards of 73 inches at the highest to 5 inches from the ground at the lowest. So it gives you a real, real big range of visibility when you're dealing with one of these units. So now that we've kind of covered everything about, you know, mounting it, what the heck this thing can do, how do you actually interact and use one of these things? So of course, with our camera, there's really one way to mainly to view the video. The video is going to be active during a SIP call, and that would be either if the intercom itself is actually called, either by dialing, you know, say its IP address, if you're doing a standard point-to-point configuration, by calling its direct extension number, if you're using a PBX system, or potentially a full DID number, depending on what phone system that you have it up there, have it up on. But there are some caveats when you're dealing with any kind of video support, and it's really important, one, to make sure that your provider supports H.264 video. If they don't support the video, you're not going to be able to utilize the video capability, and it's really down to the provider that you're using. And unfortunately, video really hasn't taken on as much as one would expect when you're dealing with different hosted providers. And there's a lot of reasoning as to why most hosted providers don't support H.264 in person-to-person calls. Of course, most of them do support, you know, video calls, but when they say that, they're specifically talking about, you know, your general video meetings where you're having, you know, potentially up to upwards of 20, 30 people on a call, and kind of, you know, the Zoom session, as, you know, the colloquial term has become, where, you know, you get on a Zoom meeting with everybody and you can communicate with people that way. And that's kind of a different thing to wrap your head around, where that's more of a meeting, where we're dealing strictly with a call. A call would be, you know, a person-to-person call where, you know, John is calling Sally or Sally's calling Mary. You've basically just got two people that are picking up the phone and calling each other. And unfortunately, that style of video is not always supported. So it's really, again, up to the particular provider if you can even use the service. And then, of course, you know, expecting that you are using a provider, either local on-prem or hosted, that does support video, whatever's going to be receiving the call has to support video. So, of course, if you're just dealing with, you know, kind of your older, say, like SNOM or Poly phones that don't support video, and it's getting a call from a video compliant device, it's not going to show the video. So not only is it important for the provider to support video, but whatever's going to be calling and interacting with the intercom, either, again, calling the intercom or receiving a call from the intercom, has to support that H.264 video. Thankfully, though, today, especially, you know, with the current situation across the world, most people are using apps or programs on their computer to actually interact with stuff. Not as many people are using physical desk phones right now, at least. I'm sure we'll get back to that as we kind of get past the current situation. But currently, a lot of people are using apps or programs to be able to interface with different people using their phone system. You know, I personally, I'm a Zoom customer, and, you know, internally at CyberData, we use 3CX. So a lot of people are using soft clients now. And a lot of these soft clients or soft phones, basically, again, just essentially an app or a program that, you know, basically just runs the phone system, support the capability for H.264. So you need to have something that could actually receive the video call and actually display it. There's lots of different actual, you know, physical desk video phones that you can get, you know, things like the A-Link T58V or even the T58A. Or even some of the Poly phones, say the VVX 500 or 600 or the 601, as well as, you know, lots of different Cisco phones. There's a lot of different providers out there that actually make physical phones that support video. But really, the most important things when you're considering on how you use this thing is just having support for H.264 video, of course, with that provider, and as well as on the hardware that's actually receiving the calls. So to talk a little bit more about the accessories that our units use, these kind of accessories are pretty standard across all of our intercom products. All of the intercoms can use these accessories. There's no, say, special accessories only for the video intercom. But the accessories that we have, starting from the top left of our images here, are the networked dual door strike relay, part number 011375. It's actually one of my favorite units that we have here. That one's super cool, and you can check out some of the other CyberSchool videos that we've done about that unit in particular. Really powerful, really trick. We've also got the intermediate door strike relay up there in the top right-hand corner, and that one's part number 011269. Then we've got two options for weather shrouds. When you're going to be placing these units outside and, you know, a non-covered area, it's always good to protect the investment and really, you know, just spend that little bit of extra money to, you know, make that investment go a little bit longer. And the weather shrouds really do a lot more than you would expect. You know, frankly, a little piece of sheet metal can do, but it really can make a big difference when you're implementing hardware like this. And the two part numbers for those, for the 1X unit that'll fit our standard kind of single button intercom, that would be part number 011188. And if you're going for the two, what we call the 2X unit, which would be either the keypad unit or the key card unit, that would be part number 011215. And we're getting a lot of customers that, especially today, in doctor's offices and scenarios like that, especially for patient intake areas, they're opting to use video cameras and video control to be able to communicate with, you know, patients, you know, especially say at hospitals or doctor's offices that may potentially have COVID or may have some other kind of illness. So the flush mount kits are very powerful when you want to use one of these things indoors, because frankly, it can kind of look just tacky having, you know, this big intercom mounted on the wall. You've got this big stainless steel box that's kind of protruding from the wall. It doesn't look, you know, clean and modern. And that's where the flush mount kit comes in, because it gives you that capability to actually recess the gang box of the intercom in your drywall and actually in the wall. So you've got this nice stainless steel surface to be able to deal with. And it makes it a lot cleaner. You don't have that big gang box sticking off the wall. You just got an intercom on your wall. And the two part numbers for those, again, in the 1X and the 2X option. For the 1X, we've got part number 011443, as well as for the 2X, part number 011442. And again, the nice thing with these, especially in our current times, you know, it's going to be a stainless steel finish on the flush mount kit, as well as the front faceplate of the intercom. So it makes it really easy if you have to go through and do, you know, kind of your daily sanitizing and cleaning of these surfaces. The stainless steel is very easy to clean, and you're not dealing with a lot of big grooves or anything that's very tough to be able to get in there and clean. And then finally, one of the last accessory units that I want to cover, just because this is a super powerful unit, especially with units that can be placed outdoors, say for a shipping dock, is a strobe kit. The unit that I would recommend to pair with this would be our auxiliary outdoor RGB multicolor strobe kit, part number 011490. And the nice thing with these is they plug directly into the intercom, and the color and blink pattern is actually driven off the activity of that particular intercom. So say, for example, if the intercom is in a call, it can illuminate a single color. And then if you're using it with multicast, or even the Night Ringer capability, it can illuminate, meaning it can light up in a different pattern in its blink pattern, as well as a different lighting, because it's, again, RGB, it's multicolor. It has that capability on the fly to change its color. You don't have to change any lenses or anything like that. You can pick whatever fancy color of pink or mauve or what have you, thanks to the RGB LEDs that we have on the unit itself. So finally, in conclusion, should you use video intercoms? There's a lot of things to actually consider when you're dealing with one of these things. You know, it's not just as simple as I want a video intercom and I'm going to install it and it's going to work on any phone provider. The audio will work, but the video might not. So there's a lot of things to consider when you're trying to figure out if video is right for your current situation. And one of the first things that I always like to ask customers, you know, do you already have an existing video camera system? Are you planning on this being kind of the first unit into your as you're kind of dipping your toes into the idea of getting a video camera system? Or could this be a supplementary device to your existing video camera infrastructure? Because that can really make a difference for people. Not to say that, you know, if you have a full video surveillance system, you shouldn't get one of our units. Or if you don't and you're just trying to dip your toes in the water, it's just a good thing to consider if you've already got support for a video camera system. And the next two are extremely important are, you know, of course, does the provider that you're currently working with support video? And that's one thing that I always stress with customers. I speak with a lot of people during, you know, initial pre-sales, and they're saying, you know, oh, I just switched over to, you know, such and such hosted provider, and I'm looking at your video intercoms. And it's like, oh, well, you know, unfortunately, I don't know if you know about this, but that particular provider doesn't support video. So frankly, I wouldn't go and spend the extra money on a camera that you may or may not be able to use in a couple years from now. You know, if that provider eventually does start supporting H.264 video, because if they don't, you're essentially paying for a camera you can't use. And I personally wouldn't spend the money to do that if the provider that you're currently working with doesn't support video. But then also, you know, another thing to consider as you're trying to plan for a video access control system are the other hardware that you might need to purchase. You know, if you've got an existing audio only phone system, you know, you've got some, say, older Polycom VVX300s, you know, they're audio only units, or say some Yealink, you know, T44s or T38s, you know, kind of their older audio only units. Some other things to consider if you're going to be going for video intercoms, you know, you've got a provider that supports it, you're dealing with an on-premise system, so you don't really have those restrictions. Okay, if I get this video intercom and I drop all this money on a video intercom, you also have to consider, okay, what is going to receive the calls from this fancy video device that I just paid for? I have to go out and get new video phones for all the people. So that can really kind of balloon up the price a little bit. There's ways that you can offset that cost by getting different tools. For example, say like our cyber soft phone, which supports that H.264 video, or even say, for example, with tools like 3CX, they offer a phone that you can use that depending on the option that you get from your particular provider might actually support video and might be free. So you might not have to go out and drop, you know, $300 or $400 on fancy video phones for everybody, because you can just download some software and use that instead. It's a lot cheaper to buy people headsets to be able to communicate with somebody through a computer than it is to go out and buy, you know, video phones for all of your different employees. And then finally, the kind of the last question there, is being able to view the user at the intercom actually important to the business? You know, sometimes people will go and spec out and, you know, kind of just look for the best possible option. Frankly, sometimes just on price, they see that, oh, this unit is more expensive, this means I have to have it, without really considering how it's going to be used. And depending on the application, video really might not be necessary. If it's a small mom and pop, like a small mom and pop thrift store, you know, and they've got, you know, a intercom at their back door for deliveries from people that are just trying to donate stuff to the thrift store. Is it really important for them, you know, in that situation, you know, running a thrift store, to be able to see who's at the back door? Maybe not necessarily. They might be fine with just an audio only unit. So it's really, you know, a lot to consider when you're speccing out opting for potentially video intercoms. You know, you need to understand if the provider that you're using supports video, if the hardware that you currently have supports video, because that can be, you know, that can really balloon up the price of getting into stuff. And then also, you know, just is actually being able to see who's at the intercom actually important for the use case of the particular business? Just all important things to consider as you're going through and speccing out using a video unit. And then finally, I just wanted to cover some terms that we went through. H.264 is a term that we definitely threw out a lot today, and it's just kind of a codec or a way that video can be encrypted and sent across the network. And it's used quite a bit throughout, you know, of course, in telephony is how we're, you know, talking about it today. But it's used in a lot of different industries, anywhere from, you know, your regular YouTube video to Netflix and, of course, back to telephony. So it's a really, really powerful protocol that's used to just be able to transmit, you know, video from one device to another. Bitrate is another term that we threw out, and that's basically just the speed of the data that's being sent from a particular device. And that ties in with H.264, because the thing when they designed H.264 is they want to be able to send high quality images at the fastest bitrate possible. And that's kind of where these two terms come in. And then finally, we've got UHD, which is a term that you'll really hear thrown around today, especially if you're looking at, you know, new TVs, you know, especially if people watching the big game. You know, people usually want, you know, their crystal 4K HD, ultra HD TVs. And, you know, it's kind of a buzzword that nobody really understands, but that's just ultra high definition. So it's a step up above that 1080p, which would just be standard high definition.
Thank you for watching this edition of Cyber School. If you have any questions, please get in contact with our sales department. They're available by email at sales@cyberdata.net or by phone at 831-373-3000. 2601 extension 334. Please make sure to like this video and subscribe for more content like this from CyberData.